Good evening. We're going to start the study session for March 19th on student support. The desired outcomes this evening are to develop understanding about the level of academic and behavioral supports available for all students, including students with disabilities, as well as develop an understanding about the role of the Kyrene Special Education Parent Advisory Council, KSEPAC. Dr. Schauer?
Thank you, Madam President. We are really looking forward to this study session because we have a comprehensive set of support for our students. And so I think, you know, we'll all get a sense of what that looks like. And there are many resources that are available. And what we know is that those resources are based in departments, or there are certain individuals that are in charge of the resources. And so as we think about using them, we're trying to figure out how to use them most effectively, you know, and efficiently. And so we've been having some meetings recently about looking at everything we have and making sure that we're using these things in an integrated way and that we're taking maximum benefit of everything we've got so that it's meeting the needs of our students. So, you know, in order to discuss this tonight, we thought we would just have Gina and Laura and Sherry lead the discussion and talk about all of the resources that are available. And then, of course, if you have questions or comments, we can answer those as well. So I'll turn it over to the three of you.
I just wanted to make note as we get ready to present that when we reconfigured the arrangement of educational services, it was with the notion that we really want to eliminate the silos of work, but to really integrate the work of the Educational Services Department. And I want to congratulate Laura Neville and Sherry Dukes for their work together. We've really done a much better job in the last year or two of really integrating the work of curriculum and exceptional student services. And it was the intent of the reconfiguration of the Educational Services Division to make that a little easier to happen, and I think we've been successful with that. So I wanted to just share that as an intro and then let these two folks talk a little bit about their work.
Okay. Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Schauer, thank you so much. We're excited to share with you the work that we are doing on behalf of Kyrene students. We're also going to acknowledge one of our other partners in crime, and that is Mark Scherer in the Technology Department. He's back there, what? Because much of what we're doing tonight and what we share with you is predicated on the technology that we have available to us. So we want to be very clear that it is a collaborative effort on multiple people's part to bring about the programming that we do for Kyrene students. So when we think about our work, we thought it would be important for you to understand the context of the work and how, when we go about it, we're looking at all students first and foremost. That's the district goal, that's in our blueprint, that all students are making continuous progress. So we have to start by having a viable core curriculum that all students get, that it makes sense, that it's appropriate, that's aligned to state standards, so that we know that there are clear targets for students and that we are essentially eliminating poor core instruction as a reason why students are not successful. So that is our first goal, is to really ensure that there's fidelity, quality instruction for all students. And then we will work in phases, and we'll talk through that this evening with you. One of the things that we think about when we're talking about a quality adopted resource is when we have state standards, we go through those and we say, here's what students need to know, understand, and be able to do. What resources are teachers and students going to need to have available to learn how to do those things? And that's when we do a resource adoption. Many of you have been on the board at a time when you've approved an adoption of resources or supplemental resources. And that's really that part of the programming where we say, here's what our targets are, and here are the resources that we believe will help teachers and students be successful. So when we screen that material, when we're doing a request for proposal or an RFP, we're looking at content standards. We're saying, does it actually have the content necessary? That's the first screening level. And typically, in years past, you were happy if you had maybe 70 or 75% match, because Arizona standards were not the same as California or Texas, which were the big markets where they were trying to sell textbooks. So you really had to do a lot of supplemental material to make sure that you were covering all the standards. The promise, I think, of Common Core is that in the next few years, we will see new resources from the big publishers that align much closer to 90, 95, or 100%. So we won't be scrambling as much to find and fill those gaps. So that's the first piece, is ensuring that you have a viable curriculum, that it's very clear, and that it's supported with quality resources. We also, when we're doing our resource adoption, look at the pedagogy. Does it support good instruction? We've talked to you about Common Core and the kind of instruction that's necessary, the high level of instruction and the rigor. So we look at that when we look at materials. And we also look at the assessment, that the data and information that teachers can glean from students as they're moving through the instructional process. We have instructional minute guidelines in reading and math at the elementary because we know it's critical that we have focused instruction. And that in addition to the core time, we have instructional focus time and additional time in other programming and special education to provide services where needed. The instructional focus groups we've shared with you before are those times when, in addition to core instruction, students who are ready to move faster, further, ready to go on, are getting opportunities to do that. We have students that are at benchmark that we want to keep moving, and then we have students we know that are not being successful. And so that's a time where we can separate those students into different smaller groups and allow them to receive instruction in reading and math explicitly to help them with their skill deficit. I know I'm talking fast. We have a lot to cover. Just tell me to slow down or ask a question. And I think the other piece when we talk about this, when we talk about instructional program, it's not just the academics that we think about, because we know that behavior and academics are integrally tied, that one impacts the other. And so we are always mindful of what are our expectations for students' behavior in addition to our expectations for their academic attainment. And so through the process of codes of conduct, and programs like character counts and other types of expectations that schools have, we have a clear set of behavior expectations and outcomes that we work with students, in particular in a positive way, because we want to focus on what we want to see students, what we want to see them learn, how we want to see them behave. That which you pay attention to, you get more of. And so that's really the premise behind that. I'm going to ask Sherry to tell you a little bit more about the positive behavior piece, because that's an area that she really helps support us in.
Madam President, Dr. Schauer, and the board members, thank you. It's a pleasure to speak with you tonight about positive behavior and just supports for students in general. PBIS, which is Positive Behavior Intervention and Supports, we presented last year on this from several of our schools and what we're doing. It really is a focus on making sure that we all understand what behavior should look like. We teach what appropriate behavior is in every part of the building, the cafeteria, the classroom, entering into the building, the lunchroom. And then we reinforce that and we encourage students through positive means to continue with that type of behavior. And so right now we have about half of our schools that are currently implementing PBIS at their sites. We have 7 other schools this year that are currently in year one training to learn more about positive behavior intervention and supports so they can implement the following year. And then we'll have next year our last group of schools that will be participating in the training and then implementation. So far we've been really excited about what we're seeing. And you've probably, you've been at the buildings, I know at Apprende, there's posters that are talking about the expectations. You may have received something from your children at home about what are the expectations that should happen in the building and the cafeteria and some of those hopefully positive coupons that your kids are receiving. And so that is a little bit about PBIS.
Another piece that I forgot to mention about the resource and the curriculum piece is we actually have standards and articulated standards for every course, grade level, and content area. So I'm not sure that that's always clear, and Sherry kind of reminded me, when we get into our work, we forget that you don't know all of our work. So I want to make sure that we're painting the best picture we can to help you understand how we go about it. And so that way you feel like you're well informed about that. So we are looking, again, at standards for every course that we offer, every grade level, and every content area. We're also working on assessments to align with that for the teacher evaluation. So that's some of the work that ties into all of this as well. Now I'm going to ask Anna to take us out to the web for a second. Because that our conversation as Dr. Schauer started talking to you about the resources. So we have a number of print resources, we have traditional textbooks, then we have a lot of online resources that are available, either specifically due to the core text or supplemental. So I just wanted to share with you quickly, this is the student version of educational resources. Parents can see this, I believe, when they go on, and I believe you all have actually staff access, so if you log into SchoolNet when you go on the web, you can see the same thing. So each of these buttons, if you will, clicks onto a resource. They are core resources, they are supplemental resources, they are a variety of text and content. One of the challenges with Common Core is to provide more text for students. You may have heard comments or concerns about that. And one of the things we've said is we actually own quite a bit already through our online resources. Through the Arizona Library resource, we can get Time for Kids, National Geographic for Kids. We don't need to buy additional textbooks. There are lots of nonfiction texts which help us meet the Common Core that we already have access to through our subscriptions. In addition to things like Fluency Tutor, TransMath, other types that are actually intervention programs for students who've been identified for that.
There is also on this site called Read and Write Gold, and that is on available for every single student in the district, and that's one of the exciting things about being in this district is that helps students access reading and writing that may have difficulty. So it doesn't have to be a student with a disability. It may be a student that's currently just learning the English language. It just may be a student that is not as strong in reading, and this is a tool that's on every computer in the district. It's a really awesome tool that is utilized.
And Anna, if you could click over to the other web page. What we wanted to share with you, too, is the access for teachers and what we've done in the last year and a half building the resources. You've probably heard my spiel about one-stop shopping, and this is really what it looks like for teachers at the elementary. We also have middle school pages, but just to quickly see that as an elementary teacher, when I go onto the web, I can see all of my curriculum maps and my related resources that are available online through the web. They don't have to go find these things in different places. It has the list of intervention materials that we have available. Most of those are print resources. That's why they're static. They're not live. But anything else that you see with an underline is a live resource. It takes them somewhere else on the web. It takes them to our T drive, their documents, their resources. So we're trying to make it where teachers' time is spent on planning, not finding things. They can go to one place, and they should be able to find everything they need. And if they can't, we tell them to call us because it's there. We just have to find it for them. Thank you, Anna. And two. One of the things that we know about, if we've done a good job with core instruction and we've implemented with fidelity all the things that we've attended to, we know from research that that's going to work for about 85% of the students, usually just as is, with very little modification. We know that there's probably about another 15%. They're going to need something else. And so that's the next level of what do we do when students need to move further, faster, or when they need some additional support. So that's when we start to look at more intense instruction, more focused instruction that's usually outside of the core materials. I like to say we don't go slower and louder. We actually use different materials to help students understand. We present instruction in a different way using different materials that are more explicitly designed based on the student's identified need. And that's really our goal when we start to look at this level of kids who are not being successful. When we're talking about behavior, this might look like a behavior plan where normally my interaction with a student works for most of the students. For another student who's continuing to struggle or disrupt or have problems, then I'm going to sit down as the classroom teacher, probably with the student, the parent, and typically the school administrator, and we start with a school plan. We start with a little behavior plan to help do something on behalf of that student. We do the same thing academically through our intervention program to say we have a kiddo that we're concerned about. We have a student. Here are some things that we need to try, and we're going to set up a time period we're going to try it, whether it's behavior or academics. A 3-week, 6-week, you set up a window, and then you monitor it. You collect data, whether it's assessment data or you're actually doing tally marks of behaviors, desired or undesired behaviors, and the group comes back together, whether it's the grade level team, the teacher, the parent, the administrator, who's ever monitoring that student for success at that point. So that's a key piece to this. And as I said, with the intervention, and we just showed you on the website some of those materials, that these are specifically designed to address student deficits. These are no longer core general programs. These are much more focused. When we talk about reading, we would be looking at vocabulary or fluency or comprehension, where we really dig deeper into really helping support students.
So when we look at some students, there are some students that need something different than what interventions or the core curriculum can provide, and that is first looking at gifted services. And so we have almost 10% of our population is identified gifted. We are a very smart district. The national average is 6%, so just to kind of put that in perspective. We look at a student is identified as gifted once they're assessed and they are at above 97th percentile in either verbal, quantitative, or nonverbal reasoning. We have a range of services for them through consultation, our clustering model, academic replacement in fourth and fifth grade, and then we also have our self-contained, which we're doing some expansion for the next year. In terms of special ed, and there is a slide separate for this, we'll go a little bit more in depth, but basically 8% of our population has been identified as special education. And just to put that number in perspective, federally they say that it should be about 6 to 8%. The state monitors us every year, and the state looks at if we're in between 7 and 10%. So as you can see, wherever we fall federally or statewide, we're right in that range of identifying the right children for special education. So that's really important to realize.
Then we also know that there are still students who are going to have difficulties, that we want to make sure that we are adding additional time, additional different materials, and usually specialized staff at this point that they are working with to really help them be successful. It could be on the behavior side of things. This is where we get our behavior teacher specialists involved, working with the school, working with the student and the parents to be very closely monitoring students before we would look at other types of alternative placements or things like that. There's always a continuum of services, and we add more and more until the student's successful and doesn't need it. That's always our best hope. I always talk about in special education, the best job would be that you're out of a job, that those students are successful and independent. That's always our goal, to move the student into core with little or no support. But we also know that there are kids who come from a variety of backgrounds for a variety of issues, medical and otherwise, that are going to need more intense support. So that's when we're, each of these, hopefully it feels maybe a little bit like a microscope where you're just focusing in each level to make sure that you're addressing, again, very specifically the types of materials. At this point, when we're talking about intervention, in the first level, we might be using Harcourt, which is our core reading program, and they have an intervention kit that is a basic intervention kit. But then we also go outside and we look at programs specifically designed for students with special needs to intervene with reading difficulty, like Wilson Reading Program. If you're familiar, that's a pretty well-known one, Linda Mood Bell. Those types of programs, they're very intense, very specific and explicit, programmed, directed instruction, as opposed to the classroom instruction, which would not feel as directed. But again, as we're honing in on the student's need, we're trying to be very precise and almost surgical in our work with students at that level. This, again, is an additional time period, too. So normally with CORE, we have 90 minutes for reading, 90 minutes for math. For the students that need additional help, maybe K-3 or instructional focus group, those are 30 additional minutes. Here would be at least another additional 30 minutes, typically. And depending on the IEP, there could be more and other things.
Mm-hmm. And so part of this is, as we have students that have more and more difficulty, we typically layer more and more levels of service on them to really try to remediate their difficulties before we look at special ed. One of the things that we do look at for a few students is what's called a Section 504 accommodation plan. And that is when a student has a physical or mental impairment that substantially limits a major life activity. And so for the majority of students, when you look at an educational setting, that's considered learning as a major life activity in schools. And so typically students may be eligible if their mental or physical impairment may limit them in some area. It also could be in breathing, severe asthma. They may require more than just a health plan. They may require an accommodation plan. Accommodation plan really allows for some accessibility for students so they can access the core curriculum and the interventions. It is different than special ed, and so that sometimes those two things get very confusing for folks. So a 504 accommodation plan is under the Office of Civil Rights, and it really looks at it's a discrimination statute, and it really looks at reasonable accommodations for a student. And there is a wealth of things that fall under a 504. When you move into special ed, which is going to be our next slide, and we talk about the eligibility piece, special education is under the Individuals with Disability Education Act, IDEA. And that is very prescriptive, and there are 13 categories of eligibility. And there are very specific steps that a district has to take in terms of looking at, is a student eligible for special education or are they not eligible for special education? One of the district's requirements is child find. We are obligated to locate, identify, and evaluate children that we believe have a suspected disability. That is certainly something that we do. We currently work with private schools with our geographical boundaries. We work with private preschools. We work with homeschool students as well as students within our own school buildings. So we have an obligation to that. There is a process that we look at, and when Laura was talking about Common Core and some of the interventions, we certainly want to make sure that the Common Core is being implemented with fidelity. We look at the needs of the student and then the interventions. We're monitoring, we're collecting data, we're intensifying, and if those are still not meeting that student's needs, we're then moving into special ed, looking at, does a student have a disability that requires special education? Which is really this distinct difference between 504 is a 504, again, is accommodation. Special ed is specially designed instruction. And it does have to fit under those 13 categories. So I know sometimes we'll hear that district doesn't identify a child with dyslexia. We do, as you've seen with some of the supports and services, we do identify children with reading difficulties. We do provide Common Core curricular materials. We do provide interventions. We do work very hard at remediating students with reading disorders. But we also identify students with reading disabilities, and typically it falls under what's called a specific learning disability, which is our highest category of eligibility, and that's typically where a student with a reading disability would fall was in the specific learning disabled category. So do we use the word dyslexia? No, that is a typical term on the outside. That's typically a medical term. Do we recognize that students have dyslexia? Do we recognize that students have reading disorders? Absolutely. What we do know in the world of special ed is the numbers of special ed identified students has gone down considerably because of the increase in interventions, and specifically for students with learning disabilities, because that is the highest category of eligibility. Typically about 40 to 50% of all your children in special ed will be specific learning disabled, and that is very much what our district is as well. The other category of eligibility, which is the second category, is speech-language impaired. That's typically the second in the nation and the second in our district. Typically, the third, fourth, and fifth look at emotional disabilities and other health impairment. Autism has been creeping up. In our district, autism is actually the third highest category of eligibility. So I think that's really important. We're seeing an incredible growth nationwide, but in our own district, we see an incredible growth. So when we look at eligibility, we do what's called a comprehensive approach. We look at multiple factors to see, does the child, one, have a disability, and two, do they require specially designed instruction or special education? And then if they do, we really look at that continuum of services. So we always are required by law to start at general education first and have that conversation. Can the child's needs be met just in a general education setting with supports? Then we move into more of the specialized instruction. You may have heard resource classroom or self-contained classroom. We also look at special day programs, so a private school. We can look at residential, and we have in the past, and we also are required to look at hospital homebound. And we do have students that are on homebound services that's how they access their education, is at home by a certified teacher that goes to their home to provide that instruction. So it really is a continuum based on the needs of the student. One of the beauties, I believe, in our district is we started 4 years ago what's called the it's called KCPAC. It's the Kyrene Special Education Advisory Council, and it was started myself, a group of parents really started talking about how can we increase collaboration between parents and educators so that we're really making positive outcomes for students with disabilities. So we started out, our first couple meetings were just developing a mission statement. And that's what we did as a group. Parents and educators alike just sat down and said, okay, what should our goal be? And we're in our fourth year, and what we do as a team, it's a planning, a parent planning team and myself, we really look at what do parents need. So we've presented from what's transition look like from preschool to K, middle school to high school, from fifth to sixth. We've done several presentations on positive behavior supports. We've done it on meeting sensory needs, or on meeting the motor needs of your child. We have had a panel of a teacher, a parent, and a principal just talking about special ed from their multiple perspectives. So we really try to see what is the need of the community, what is the need of the educators, because we're hoping both will come. One of the presentations we did were with last year with two attorneys. One was a parent attorney and one was a school district attorney, and that was quite interesting just to hear their multiple perspectives. So we really try to say what is it, what's the concerns out there, what are the questions, and how do we address it. And so that's special ed keeps us quite busy, but it's certainly there's a lot of supports and services and the ESS department with the curriculum and learning and the technology. We really work in collaboration to try to meet the needs of all kids.
Just in summary, hopefully the key message that you heard is that we wrap our services around students. We don't say we have this program and this kiddo has to fit into a program. We look at the student and we say, what does the student need? And how can we deliver those services in the way that's least disruptive to the student, that's going to support the student best? And that's exactly the continuum that Sherry just shared with you. The other key to it is that it is monitoring, and we've shared with you things like DIBLs, where we have set schedules, and the same thing is true at all levels of the continuum of services. We're constantly looking at our students being successful with the intervention, whether that intervention is extra time in the classroom or a special needs classroom. They're still monitoring whether or not that's working on behalf of that student, because once a student is placed or receiving services, it doesn't stop. We have to see if that intervention is actually working, and if it's not, we have to continue to look at what we can do differently to help that student be successful. And of course, our final goal is that we are looking for all kids to be successful. Wherever they're at, we want to be able to take them and move them along. And so that's always first and foremost in our minds as we're looking at the programming and the services that we deliver. Questions?
Thank you for your presentation. I have a question, then I'll start going down the row. You were talking about, I'm going with just more of the special ed, mm-hmm. and you were saying that number three now is autism, mm-hmm. it's increasing, and all the positive behavior that we're working on trying to get that. I've been hearing from some teachers and some staff that there seems to be an increase in, assault on teachers, but teachers being physically, mm-hmm. assaulted, I guess is the best word. And I want to see if you've been seeing that, and if that's the case, what's the district been doing about that? Because I've been hearing about that's a concern for some of the teachers in some of these classrooms that deal with those students. And so what are we doing, especially when we're trying to really do that PBIS district-wide, how are we resolving that, and what is it that you see that we can do about that?
So when we have students that have significant behavior, so we believe those are the few students, as well as some of our students in special ed, which are very few, that are at that aggressive, there are several things. One, when we see that we have a student that has great needs, we have behavior intervention teachers that are working with that team, providing strategies, providing supports. We also, if it's a student with autism, because not all students that are in that position of behavioral issue are students with autism, but if they are, we also have what's called our autism teacher team specialist. It's called CAT. Everyone has acronyms. And so really that group of folks will go out, provide observations, provide strategies, help to build visual supports, social supports around the child. If all of those things aren't working and we've implemented the IEP as it's been written, we believe that we have extinguished what we need to do. We also look at what's called the least restrictive environment. So that would be a continuum of services. So we do have students in special day programs that are outside of the school district. So if a student in general education or resource may need more support, we typically look at our self-contained program. If they're in our self-contained program and it's still, we're not meeting their needs basically because their behavior is saying something's not right, is that we then look at special day programs. And we do have students out in special day programs currently right now. And then we work with that special day school, which are all outside of our district but surrounding our community, to make sure our students are making progress, because our goal is to bring them back to the school when they are ready.
Did ever come to the case where then we would not allow the student back, or say, you know, that this student cannot be in this classroom or this school anymore, and so they're out of the district? I mean, I'm just wondering, do we do that? Do we disenroll students for situations like that?
Or can we
legally do that?
Yeah, under IDEA, we can't unenroll, we can't just disenroll them. But what we can do is we closely monitor. So typically, if a student is placed in a special day program, then it's one of our behavior intervention teachers is usually the contact person. They're attending all the individualized education plan meetings, those IEP meetings, talking about the student's progress. There's specific goals for the student that student needs to master before we start considering, are they ready to be integrated back into a school setting? So we really, we have students that are ready and they come back and they're very successful. We have students that sometimes they come back and they do well for a period of time and then not so well, and so we reconsider their placement options. So it really is individualized based. Thank you.
Ms. Coggins?
So when we do outsource, is there a certain criteria then? I mean, is this something that the parent and the team works to find the right place to outsource them? And I'm assuming it's probably, you know, all sorts of degrees and qualified personnel that,
well,
or how does that work?
It's interesting. Good question. What happens is the Arizona Department of Education has a list of private day schools that we can consider that they have evaluated and determined will provide the right level of support. And then what we do as a district is we go out and we go visit those programs because we are looking at certain things really that emulate what we do in our buildings. And are they able to meet the needs of our kids? Are they able to provide the level of services? Because just because they're a special ed private day placement doesn't mean they all provide the same level of service. And so we do that, and then it's a meeting. The parent is at that meeting. It's called an IEP meeting. A team decides that it's the level of service, then it's typically the district deciding on the location of those services. But the parent is part of that conversation the whole time.
Okay, and then when or is there a percentage of how many of our special ed students actually have to engage at that? Do we have
you know
that?
What? It's actually in terms of what the state monitors special education every year. And they're called actually public education agency indicators, or PEA. Mm-hmm. And that is one of the indicators. You can have no more than 1% of your special ed population in special day schools.
Okay.
So that's just really important. So it's a very small number. So the state is saying you should have a small number in special day. You should be able to address the needs of a vast majority of your students.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
I just have two quick questions. Does a student have to be either, I'm not sure the right term, eligible or qualified for special education to have an IEP, individual education plan?
Yes, they do.
Okay, so yeah. If there are other interventions, are those just documented kind of informally, or how do you check and make sure what's happening?
Correct. So if we're looking at a student who's not already been through the process and identified, so they're usually maybe on their way, they're starting to show some struggles, we have the KSIT process, and you have to remind me what KSIT, they always just call it KSIT.
It's Kyrene Student Intervention Team.
Thank you, we just call it KSIT. So, and that's the sort of that first level, when we notice that things aren't working for a student, whether it's behavior or academic, when then we start to monitor it, and we start to identify the key areas that the student needs assistance in, what are the interventions, and how long, and how are we going to monitor it. Come back in, say, 3 weeks, whatever time frame, is it working, is it not working? And that's going to continue to the point where we said, we have tried it, we've tried it with fidelity, it's not working. And then they might go then to the next level, which is requiring or asking for an evaluation of the student for special education services. So it is, you know, the idea is, again, that we eliminate all the other factors of why a student's not being successful. It's quality instructions, quality materials, it's adjustments to instruction to help meet the student's needs that are within reasonable, you know, expectations. Once it goes beyond what would typically be taken care of, then we start to say, no, this is something beyond. This is a student who may qualify for additional services and should have those additional services.
And then is there any kind, if you don't meet the you know, you said that the federal guideline or recommendation, it would be 6 to 8% of the population, and that the state monitors that. What if you were to be 9 or 10%? Is there a penalty? Does something happen?
Well, fortunately, we can go up to 10% without a penalty. But basically, after that, we have to write a corrective action plan on how, because what the state is saying and what we know is that we are probably not either doing the appropriate level of core instruction or the right intervention. So what we know is that we need to really look at our practices. So we don't, and I think there's a myth out there that we're like tallying it up. Are we close? Are we close? Are we close? We actually look at this at the end of each school year. So it's not a conversation because we also have to look at disproportionality of students as well. So we look at both disproportionality by ethnicity, as well as are we over-identifying or under-identifying students for special ed by school as well as by district.
And I think I just want to make a comment. I think I mentioned before that all three of my kids went through Kyrene. My first two were identified special ed, and there was no such thing as KCPAC. And so, I mean, you know, I've been to several mm-hmm. of your meetings, but I think that is such a good resource for parents, because you really do address what the parents in the group say that they would like to learn about and hear about, and you have experts come and speak, and there's a tremendous amount of resources. And I mean, by the time my sons were in eighth grade, I was a pro at dealing with IEPs and strategies and stuff. But when you're first starting with that, there's so much to understand and know, and how to work with teachers and everyone. So anyway, I really applaud your efforts with that. I know it's helping parents, and I just encourage, you know, I'd like to see more people take advantage of that group.
Well, thank you, Mrs. Hirsch. I would want to say that it goes both ways, because not only does it help for the parents, but it also helps the educators get the parent perspective. We believe that we have the parent perspective, but it's really nice to be able to sit in a room and hear that what we thought we were training on and what actually materializes sometimes are sometimes two different things, and that helps us really know what we need to hone in on, so to make that experience a good experience for both sides.
And just from the parent perspective, you know, sometimes you can feel like everybody else has perfect kids that are adjusting to school just fine, and you're the one person that has kids. So I think that's it's a good sense of support for those families too. Thank you.
Is every student that is designated for special ed eligible for some kind of weighted funding?
Yes.
So Jeremy got up. He heard the word funding. He's quickly running to the microphone.
It's Group B funding that we receive for special ed.
So every special ed student is eligible for some weighting of additional funding.
Yes.
What happens if a student is designated for special ed in the middle of the school year? How does the funding get done?
He can't help himself, so I have to let him.
On?
You guys hear me? I can hear you.
Based on the day, so say if it's like the 90th day, since we get paid for the first 100 days, well, actually, with special ed, it would be the census dates. Mm-hmm. So let's
so
say
it's pro, so it's prorated
yeah,
in
it's
some ways.
Okay.
prorated. We've covered the. After I got a hint. What would be your sense of whether the district, I hate to use the word profit because that's not the right word, are we adequately funded with the weighted funding, or are we inadequately funded?
We're underfunded on special education. Queen Creek had emailed me and asked me to do some analysis for them because they were getting a lot of concerns around their special education funding. They wanted to know how they compared to their peer districts. So I did some analysis for them, and it's basically the same for everyone. You have more dollars going out for special education than what you're getting in from the state. Regardless of what your makeup is and your special education categories, that just tends to be the trend, that you're going to spend more on special education than what you're going to receive.
And what about the federal side of it, the IDEA? Does that get routed through the state, or does that come directly from the federal government?
No, that comes directly from the feds.
And they also are not funding anywhere close to the promised 40%.
That's part of the sequestration, too.
Right, exactly. The theory of all of this when IDEA came in like 1975 or whenever it was that the federal government would cover 40% of the cost of special education. I think they fund about 17%, and sequestration, I believe, is going to
cut
that even more. How many, when you talked about, did you usually say that only 1% of special ed kids or 1% of total students can be?
Special day.
So how many do we have in Kyrene? Can't be very many.
Nine.
Just nine total.
Nine students are on at special day schools.
And I assume that in those particular cases, they also are a drain on the budget, that we have to pay more to the third party school than we get in funding.
I can't use the word drain. I would just say that it is costly.
Right. That it costs more for us to pay that school than we get for the.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
Ms. Coggins?
I think one thing that I've heard is that this dyslexic, which falls in the category, which you said was the second category, the reading, what did you call it? It was the second.
It can fall in the category of specific learning disability. It doesn't necessarily fall in the category. It depends.
Okay.
But it typically falls in, not as a dyslexia, but as a student with a reading disability.
Okay, so it falls in. So what happens when we have, and this is just really me not knowing and wanting to understand, because I have come across a family that has said we've had to spend all this money at the reading clinic or wherever it is that they have to go. And, for me, it's, well, what are we doing and how are we? Because I know that we do have the reading intervention, but when we get to a point where maybe we're hitting a wall with the student, obviously, I because I'm not the expert, I know you guys know that that's probably what it is that student has. And again, that's more the medical term. But so what do we do when a family feels like they're hitting a wall or they're fourth or fifth grade and now they're going into middle school? How are we addressing it with that student so they don't continue to fall further behind?
So we currently have interventions, and as Mrs. Neville was talking about, they are leveled interventions based on the need of the student. So a student, whether they're elementary or middle school, they would participate either in the language arts sixth grade class, or they would participate in language arts class in the third grade. They would, in addition to that, they would have an instructional focus group. And if it's a student with significant, they would also have an additional intervention above that instructional focus group and above that core. Typically, the students that are in that category that really require that intense level of instruction are typically instructed by a special education teacher. Those are typically because they can look very similar to our students with disabilities, but they haven't been identified as a student with a disability at this time because we're in intervention. So they are getting an intense level of intervention with a reading program that is built for that student's needs.
So really they're getting three levels.
Absolutely.
Then. So you're getting their first level, your second, your third, and then at that point.
And if they're not making progress there, then we are moving into evaluation to say this child may have a disability.
Okay, and then they would go into like an IEP at that point.
Right.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
To Rob.
Just one more question. It's kind of what I was asking before. I was kind of having an inner turmoil about what to ask this question. I mean, I'm about 99% sure I know the answer to this question, but I think it's important for us as a district to go on record with this question and your answer, which is, are you ever aware of the district ever making a special ed decision based on a budget consideration?
No.
Thanks.
Absolutely not. In fact, if I may, sometimes I hear, and this to me is, I'd like to take an opportunity to bust a myth as well, that sometimes I hear that we look at identifying kids for Section 504 and not children under IDEA. IDEA is a funded mandate, underfunded, but it's a funded mandate. Section 504 brings absolutely no money. So if you were to say there's some financial incentive, you would probably be leaning towards IDEA versus Section 504. But in good conscience and following the procedures and guidelines set forth under 504 as well as IDEA, we look at kids that require reasonable accommodations, 504. We look at kids with disabilities that require special education under IDEA. So yes, no, we do not consider that. And under law, we can't even consider that.
We're all about busting myths.
We are busting. Kind of fun.
Hey, thank you. Dr. Schauer, anything else?
I'd just like to thank the team. You know, it's so impressive to sit here and listen to everything we have and everything we do. You guys are amazing. And our students are in really good hands because of the hard work you do. So thank you for doing this tonight. I think it was really enlightening for all of us, you know, to see what you showed online. I didn't ever see that page before, you know, and so I know we have a tremendous amount of materials.
That was another
Mythbuster. And it's very impressive, you know.
Every t-shirt. Yeah.
So hopefully someday, again, we'll have money and we can buy even more, but that's probably down the road a while. But thanks again. You did a great
Welcome.
Job.
Thank you.
Yes, I want to thank you, too. We can adjourn tonight at 6:50 and reconvene at 7 o'clock for the regular board meeting.
Nice.